Another perfect day in California. Now it's the perfect evening. And it was a Holy Spirit day. I asked the Holy Spirit, what should I do? What should I do today? There was some time, so the Holy Spirit indicated, you got to go play golf today. I said, really? I have a bad back, and but I was feeling better today. He said, okay, we'll see. And I said, Holy Spirit, do whatever you want to do here. Make the best use of time possible. Well, it turned out to be in this teaching lesson happened. I'll tell you what happened. The preface is I've been doing some writing and explaining, trying to explain to the world that we're in over our heads with artificial intelligence and the front for that, which is the United Nations. We're in over our heads. We're like drunkards right now. People are like drunk, and they're overestimating their capacity to deal with the situation that is developing in the world. Okay, so we've taken on way too much, and we're going to lapse severely. We're going to have a severe lapsing of our finesse, our functionality, as we get in over our heads, and it's going to be very bad. This is what I've been writing about. Okay, so get this. Here I am in the golf course, and there's a twosome in front of me teeing off, and they're hitting from the blacks, the farthest tee back, and you know, on this course, that's like suicidal. I mean, I said, whoa, they must be great players, because this, if you hit from the blacks here, the course is just going to eat you alive. And so I saw their balls, and I said, huh, they didn't hit them very good. I said, that's weird. And then the next hole, same thing. They hit it out of bounds. They lost their ball. They're looking for it for 5 minutes. The next hole, same thing. Lost the ball down the canyon. They're looking for it. I said, what's going on here? I'm waiting. And I said, why are these guys hitting from the blacks? They can't even play. They're not players at all, you know? I said, gosh, this is weird. So then there's this another foursome. There's a foursome ahead of them. These kids walking, and they're going so slow. These kids, four kids with a dog. A dog taking a dog on a golf course. I've never seen such a thing. And I said, wow, this is crazy. We're going to be here forever. I'm going to be here forever. So I just took off and passed the twosome ahead of me and then the foursome of the kids and went to the next hole. And I was able to play the next hole. But the twosome that I was behind that was hitting the ball out of bounds from the black tees, they also said, wow, we're not going to sit behind this foursome. These kids are going so slow. So they also bypassed them. They caught up with me at the tee on the next hole. And I said, well, you know, to be polite, I said, would you like to join me? They said, oh, yeah, sure. I said, you're hitting from the blacks. I said, oh, yeah. I said, wow, you're sure getting your money's worth today, huh? And they said, oh, we always play from the blacks. We always play for the blacks. I said, huh, really? Okay. I didn't say anything. And they proceeded to butcher the course up. And It was brutal. And what happened was it got into me and affected my game. And my game fell to pieces. Because I said, well, I'll join you in the black tees then. What the heck, you know? It's really a pain if they're playing from the black. Then I got to go to the whites. And I said, I'll play from the blacks. Who cares? I don't care anyway. Doesn't matter to me. I'm just out here exercising. But their ineptitude. It's a funny thing about golf. You tend to play the level of who you're playing with. At least I do. And so I easily go downwards if someone's just really botching it. I'll end up doing the same thing. Maybe to make them feel good, you know, not so embarrassed or something. I don't know. But it happens. This is what happened. My game went to pieces completely. Their game went to pieces. And they're drinking. They're drunk. They're smoking cigarettes. And it's like, oh my God. You know, it was just like, I said, but I stayed calm. I said, okay, Holy Spirit, what's going on? What is this? What is going on? And gradually, I just stayed calm. I just noticed everything. And I gradually began to notice that they hit the ball out of bounds, and it's gone. I mean, you're not going to find it. And they were spending all this time searching for the lost ball. And I said, why are you know? And I said, hey, this is kind of like the world. This is like an analogy for the world. Is we're taking on more than we can chew, you know, for sure. And we're not up to it. You know, repelling artificial intelligence. I mean, putting it in context and everything. We're not able to. It's ahead of us. It's too much for us. It's like we're playing from the back tees, and we cannot. We don't have the game for it. We do not have the game for it. My game held up okay, except chipping. My chipping. I couldn't do it anymore. I just gone. It was ridiculous. I don't know what happened. The finesse. My finesse vanished. This is what happened. I noticed this. When I'm out there playing with myself out there on the golf course, just as a single here. Then somehow I'm much more calm, relaxed. There's nothing, you know, going on, and I can have great finesse, you know, around the green, chipping really well. The finesse is there. With these guys and all the stuff, weird stuff that's going on, I've got so, you know, just so erratic and crazy. My finesse left me. I had no finesse at all. It was horrible. So what I discovered is what's going to happen. What's going to happen in this world, this is a metaphor for the world, is we're going to lose our finesse, which is very important. That's how you score. That's how you keep it all together. And we're not going to be able to keep it all together going forward here in this world. We're going to get in over our heads, and we're going to start flubbing stuff, and we're going to lapse back into a certain type of, you know, ineptitudes, sort of some spiritual ineptitude, actually. And it got worse and worse and worse. At one hole, I flubbed a chip, flubbed another chip. You know, hit a. It's terrible. It's terrible. And once the guys left the green, I went back and practiced, and I went to this other club. I just had the grip replaced, and I started hitting chip after chip, just right, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. I said, "Wow, it's just like something gets into you, and you lose your finesse when you're around." People who are, you know, they're overconfident in their abilities to deal with what's in front of them, and you know, and when you get drunk, you're on drugs, you think that you can do it, you can do anything, you're not really thinking properly. And this is like the world is not thinking properly, is not evaluating the situation properly at all. And so the world's like drunk, and they say, "Oh, sure, you know, we can handle this, no problem. We're gonna turn the world into, you know, perfectly behaving people. Everyone's gonna behave perfectly here, and that's gonna be utopia." You know, well, they're in for a big, big surprise. And it was a brutal, 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 brutal round lesson, you know, but I took it in stride and said, okay, I know this is Holy Spirit saying, this is what's going to happen in the world. This is what the whole purpose of going and playing golf today and seeing this and experiencing it. You know, I lost my game. And the Holy Spirit says, you don't want to play a round of golf with people like this, you see. In other words, you don't want to engage with the world in this coming times that's coming up now. You do not want to engage with them because they're drunk on overconfidence and their game is just ridiculous, and they don't have the game to handle it. There's no question about it. People spiritually do not have the spiritual game to handle what is coming. Not at all. Artificial intelligence is just, you know, devouring the planet, actually. And the United Nations is going to be the excuse, the front, to justify it all. Say, hey, folks, you know, you got to do it. Don't worry. Everything's fine. We're in charge. And they're inept. The UN is very, very inept. They're very overconfident. And their whole... Here's another thing that I may have said in the last video, but I realized today very strongly. I said, I noticed something. The Holy Spirit showed me. And it's that I saw that a lot of people in the world are into behavioralism and teaching people how to behave. And I call it like Big Mother Syndrome, right? I mean, mothers teach their children how to behave, so it's something that mothers are used to doing, like they're training, you know, train their children, this is how you behave. Okay, yeah, that's fine. But what I'm seeing is that this spirituality in the world now, it is really being approached in a manner in that they're trying to find these spiritual powers and wisdom or something that can give them the capacity to teach everybody how to behave properly. This is really how most people go into spiritual, whatever they're doing, into yoga, whatever, meditation. They're trying to see, how can I train people I want to train how to behave better? How can I get them to behave better? It's behavioralism. And this is completely off track of what spiritual goal really is. Absolutely, totally off track. And yet this is, very few go into it for actual liberation from the self-delusion. You know, most want to, you know, they want to train their dog better, they want to train their children, they want to train their spouse better, they want to train their colleagues better, they want to train this better. You know, the United Nations, what they want to do is they want to train everybody in the world how to behave properly. This is really their goal. And their religion and everything they're teaching is for that goal. They want to make perfect people. You know, this is totally antithetical to the true spiritual path. Totally antithetical. True spiritual path is to realize there are no people. There's no such thing. This is all just a dream. And it's not a behavioral emphasis. It doesn't really matter whether you're a good person or bad person. You know, if you practice, it's all about practicing. I realized this again this morning. If let's say you're some super teacher like Jesus or something, like, okay, who are you looking for? Like, if you're looking for someone in this world that you know is valuable, you say, you know, this someone's helpful. Who's really getting it? Are you gonna go looking around for like some, you know, self-righteous people like the Pharisees, Sadducees, you know, the ones that are saying, well, we're good people, we're very good people. People smile in the streets to us and bow and say, and you know, we're powerful, we're good, we're moral, we do all keep all the laws, and but we don't need to practice. What do we need to practice spiritual practice for? We're righteous people. We know we are. And then you have the sinner who says, "Hey Jesus, you know, I'm not a good person. I don't always behave properly. I mean, I don't like this world. I don't like this belief system. I think it's difficult. It's causing me problems. I really want to practice. I'm practicing." And then they've been practicing for a long, long time. Actually, every day sitting down and really doing the right kind of practices that are aimed towards, you know, awakening from self-delusion. Now, who's Jesus going to say, "Hey, you know, you're the one, you come with me, come with me," you know? Is he going to go to the self-righteous one and say, "We don't need to practice, we're good people"? And I believe the Bible talks about this a lot. Jesus points this out. Don't be like the Pharisees. Be humble, and humble enough to practice. Those who think that they're good people because they behave, they feel they behave nicely around to everyone, and they know, you know, the niceties and all this stuff. I mean, they say, I don't have to practice. Practice what? I already got it down. I know how to be a good person. That's what Jesus warns us about. Okay. So for me, I say, "Hey Jesus, I've been practicing for 40 years, intensely. I'm in my 39th year with A Course in Miracles, but I was practicing before that, actually. My whole life I've actually been practicing. I was been very intense, lifelong practicing, because I said, I'm suffering. I got to practice. I mean, I can't rely on being a good person. It's not working for me. I'm not a good person. I don't consider myself a good person. I don't look at it that way. I say, it doesn't matter. I mean, these practices have to be done, you know, if we're going to reach the goal, really, of realizing that there aren't really any people at all. It's all just a scam, this whole thing. We can't just say rest on our laurels, say, "Well, I'm a good person, so that's all," you know. No, it doesn't work that way. So you have this very self-righteous institution, the United Nations, and very self-righteous people in the world. And it's the big mommy syndrome that they're, you know, mother's going to teach all her little children how to behave, be perfect little children, how to behave properly. But in doing so, true spiritual practice will be ignored, as it's being ignored right now. Severely ignored. Because people say, "Well, I don't need to do that. I'm a good person." I mean, these kind of practices wouldn't be something that a good person would do. Some person, not such a good person, would do something like that, but not me. I don't need to do that. And I would say, it has nothing to do with your personality. Leave that personality, whether you're good or bad, out of it. It's got nothing to do with it. So if I were a teacher looking for someone, I'd look for someone who actually has been practicing. You know, that's it. I'd only look to see, are they practicing? I wouldn't look to see, are they a good person? Are they a bad person? Are they practicing? Are they really practicing? Are they getting after it and practicing? That's all I'd look at. Because that's the only thing that's important. Is, are you actually practicing every day? And I did a tremendous amount of practice day in the neither nor practice. Tremendous amount of practice. It was very, very, very intense. I used it in all sorts of ways that I hadn't thought of before. And it's just, wow. Like, I neither reject life, nor do I not reject life. I neither reject humanity, nor do I not reject humanity. It's like I said that, I felt this, wow. That really hit hard. Some of them really hit hard. You have to dig, you know, find these gold nuggets, and one of them is big and say, wow, that really, and life, I neither reject life, nor do I not reject life. And I've always said that the worst thing we can possibly have is have a life, because what we really are is eternal life, and to have a life is the denial of eternal life. So I neither reject life, nor do I not reject life. So I put a lot of effort into it, as I do every day, practice, because for me, my personality is not what people would think. Well, this, you know, wonderful personality, not really. No one's ever said I have a good personality or a bad person. I just kind of, I don't know, blah. So can't rely on that. I cannot rely on that whatsoever, the personality. So gotta practice. So these behavioralists is the reason why the United Nations is the way it's gone about things, a very, very clever way. And it's recruited the mother syndrome. It's highlighted that, because its goal is behavioralism. It's based on behavioralism. It wants us to be perfectly behaving citizens of this planet. Okay, whatever that means, which is to be hooked up and monitored 24/7 by artificial intelligence, for sure, and to have our lives governed by algorithms, okay, and computers. This is what they really are. This is what's going to happen, actually, much sooner than we realize. It's like a net that, you know, it's tightening around. We're already in the net, and they're tightening and pull the fish out. It's already ubiquitous in our society right now. So they have heavily leaned on the natural, or the, you know, the very practiced tendency of mothers to train children. They said, hey, you know, what we want you to do is we want you to help train citizens now. You know, and the mothers say, oh yeah, I'm used to training children. I should be able to learn train citizens too. And they said, sure you can. So the United Nations have been very sneakily empowering this approach, very much empowering this approach, that suddenly, you know, we'll wake up one day and we'll think, you know, everywhere we go, there's a big mother believing that we're her children, telling us how to behave properly, and of course disciplining us if we don't. It's like we're children, so everybody's gonna be treated like their children, actually needing to be disciplined. This is what's coming upon the world, and then artificial intelligence will be, you know, mommy's little helper. So you cannot go into spiritual practice trying to find some power and authority which enables you then to train someone else in how to behave properly. This is the wrong motivation, very much wrong motivation. And so I've noticed this spirituality in the world. There's something wrong with it, you know, and it's because of this. They're looking for ways to how can I... What kind of techniques, like a therapist, what kind of techniques can I get to get my patients to behave properly, you know, in a nice way? Can I become real sweet and nice and kind so my children will say, sure, Mom, I love to do what you have to say, whatever you say. They're looking for that. That's what they're really looking for. How can my children relate to me and say, oh, of course I'll do what you say. I'm happy to, because I know you're so right, and I like the way you asked me to do it, and of course I'm going to do it. So they want, you know, joyful obedience. They're looking for, how can I get joyful obedience from everybody? So they go into spiritual practice looking for those, like, those abilities to get joyful obedience. And this, of course, it doesn't have anything to do with the real spiritual path at all. And another thing I've noticed is that by doing all this kind of faux spirituality, which there's a ton of it in the world. I mean, it seems like on the internet, that's all you can find, basically. What it does is that it makes people feel righteous. Okay. And when they feel righteous, they say, well, I don't need to do that other practice. That's not necessary for me. I've done my whatever it is I've done. And this means I'm a good person. I'm behaving well. And I like others to behave well in my presence. I'm kind of nice. I'm nice. And I don't really need to do that other stuff. That's for those who are, lesser people, not me. I'm above that. I'm playing from the back tees now. And this is the trouble. This is the trouble with all this faux spirituality. And this is what the UN is promoting. It's worldwide now. It's just everywhere. And it's just like, oh, not again. Come on, are you kidding me? This isn't really getting after it at all. And yet it's like a merit badge you earn. Like, say, well, I did this and this and this, so I don't have to do that. I've done my tour of duty, so to speak, and no more. That's not the spiritual path either. The spiritual path is you work at it as diligently as you can every day, and you just keep working at it and working at it, working at it until ultimately, you succeed. You're not working at it to excuse yourself from some further work on it at all. It has nothing to do with trying to excuse yourself from more work. You're saying, I'm going to work at this until I succeed, period. We're not trying to excuse ourselves from difficult work. Say, well, I've done enough. That's good enough. No. Not at all. This is crazy stuff. This is, like drunkards who don't understand. It's like they don't have a game. They say, that's okay. I can play from the black tees. And really? You're losing your ball left. You're losing your ball right. You're spending all your time searching for your golf ball. The only golf ball I lost today was when they called me up. They were looking for their ball for 5 minutes or whatever, and climbing down the hillside. And I was waiting. Finally, they waved me up. And I was just like, oh, man. I just got to get past these guys. So I hit a lousy shot, I was just so rattled. That ball went out of bounds, lost it. I didn't even look for it. It's gone. Other than that, I didn't lose any ball at all. It was interesting. So it shows you when you're with those people, you tend to get erratic like they are. So they didn't have a spiritual game. And the people of this world don't have a spiritual game. They're way overestimating their spiritual game to an extreme extent. They think, oh, I've done a little, I've read a spiritual book. I do a little meditation in the morning. I stretch, I'll do yoga, and I do some singings, and I like to listen to Tibetan, some kind of sacred singing. I'm a nice person. I try to treat people well. I try to help people, learn to get along better, and I'm inclusive, and I like to get people different. In other words, I have a nice personality. I have a good personality. This is the trouble. That's not a game at all. That's not a spiritual. You don't have it. That's not even remotely, what it's about. So this is what's being promoted in the world. So what I got from this situation the Holy Spirit put me through was quite an ordeal, actually. I was, kept my cool, but I was just, embarrassing myself. It's ridiculous. I've never played so bad in my life, honestly. But I just said, soldiered on. I said, okay, I'm just going to learn something here, that's for sure. I'm getting taught a lesson, a tough lesson here. The wheels can come off. So I realized that my wheels can come off if I hang around these people who over-evaluate their spirituality and try to say, oh yeah, we're players too. I'm going to fall apart. I'm going to lapse. My game's going to lapse. It's very difficult to keep your game here. The finesse that's required. There's a certain kind of Very delicate, confidence that this required. There's a certain type of confidence that's required. And if you lose that finesse confidence, you lose, then your game starts falling apart, actually. Spiritual focus starts falling apart. And there's not many that understand this. You're confident that you can do this, the right practices, and you do them. But when other people don't know any of what you're talking about, you tend to try to stoop to their level, and then you lose it. So I realized, it's very important to avoid this kind of situation. Otherwise, you're going to lose your game, spiritual game, your spiritual focus. You'll lose it. And that's what the Holy Spirit's getting. Tell me, don't engage with the future here. There's got to be some way to avoid that. This is what I'm thinking. This is what I'm seeing. And this, of course, what I've been preaching my whole life, that there will come a time when we'll need to sidestep the future of this world. We need a different avenue, it's ruinous for spiritual momentum. It's ruinous. The future of this world, I see, is very, very bad. And people won't even know the difference. They really won't. I mean, these guys thought they should be playing from the black tees. I can't imagine why they should be playing. They should have been playing from the senior tees, or the ladies tees, or some. I mean, why were they championship tees? They're just brutal. They just have they had no sense of, what their capabilities were. They overestimate they're overestimating their capabilities to an extreme extent. So it's a metaphor for the world. It's a metaphor for the world. Big trouble ahead, as I've been constantly saying, is we're getting in over our heads. Kind of like the traffic in Silicon Valley. I mean, it is just outrageous now. Outrageous. It's suddenly just a spite. And cities, you go into cities, and it's virtual gridlock. You're waiting like three lights before you can even get through a light. It's changing the whole cycle, red to green to red to green, three times, just to get through it at all. You're just stuck in traffic. There's just cars everywhere. It's insane what has happened here, and they're building apartments still like crazy here. It is going to turn into a nightmare. People are just gonna losing their minds, accidents all over the place. What's happened is all the freeway traffic has flooded into the cities now. Everyone's going back roads, going surface streets to get around. There's the gridlock on the freeways, and that's gridlocking all the towns now. All day, all day. I went in at noontime today. The city, and it was just like unbelievable, gridlocked at noontime. So, and it gets worse. I mean, you go up to other places, like I heard, like Palo Alto. It's just horrendous all day. Hideous gridlock. So, it comes quickly like that, and then you realize, uh-oh, we have a severe problem here. We're in over our heads here with traffic. Now, those who live here have been preaching this for 15 years. No, nobody listens. Everyone says, hey, we can't just allow unlimited growth. We don't have the capacity. We don't have subways. We don't have rapid, transit here. This is going to be a nightmare coming up. And what do they do? Turn, oh, no, we're confident. We're overconfident. Build, 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 higher, 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 higher. Nightmare. Nightmare now. It's just, you don't even want to leave your house because you're flooded from all angles by vehicles. Just everyone's agitated, It's just like, wow, this is too intense. So, wisdom saw it coming, but those who were making money, 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 said, "Ah, that won't be a problem. Don't worry about it. We're gonna, we got game. We got a game. We can." No, they don't. So we're in over our heads here, just through severe congestion, and it's getting everybody very agitated. And like again, it's like all day now. It's like Los Angeles, except they have subways and rapid transit and various things that we don't. It's probably gonna be worse than LA, actually. I think it is the worst in the nation right now. So this is a good example. Stuff creeps up on you. It creeps up on us, and suddenly you realize, holy cow. It was just a couple of days ago, driving through town at 9 o'clock. It was just backed up. I've never seen it backed up so bad. I said, what in the world is going on? Is the president in town or something? Oh, no. But, and I talked to other people. They said the same thing where they were. They said, we couldn't even get into town. What's going on? There's just normal traffic now. I don't know. What's going on? It's just crazy. So it can suddenly spike on you. And so this world, we're going along with artificial intelligence, okay? And at some point, you know, with the United Nations, I believe today's the 14th, yeah, the 14th, I believe there is a meeting now. Is this in Bonn, Germany, October 14th through the 20th or something? I something like that, I believe. I have a graphic that maybe I'll post with this video on my blog that I made of the key dates of the United Nations going forward. The next date is this October 14th through 21st, something like that, where they what they're going to do is they're going to hammer out the pre-agreement towards for the Paris climate talks, which are in December. For about a week or more in December, maybe big worldwide meeting in Paris, okay? At that meeting in December, they're going to try and make it legally binding and agree on what a 2% carbon emission decrease, 2% decrease in carbon emissions. Legally binding. So what the United Nations is doing now is they've gone from trying to convince everybody, hey, go along, go along, go along. And now what's happened in the world of recently, last couple of years, and it's happening right now, is that they are taking this next step to legally binding agreements. Very, very important. And then so after the Paris talks in December, in July, I believe it's July 14th, through the 21st, maybe that is a meeting, a high level meeting of the United Nations where they will begin to they will make a benchmark of the progress and say, okay, we're going to start monitoring the progress. This is the first monitoring report of keeping track of reaching these 17 Sustainable Development Goals. Climate change being one of them, okay, and the goal is to, what they're trying to do is make it legally binding and start collecting data to measure the progress. So this is the first summit meeting where they're going to actually say, okay, this is the progress you've made, this is the progress, and start saying we're keeping track of everything now. All right, so that's very important. That's why the Holy Spirit's has told me that. Several years ago, it said July of 216, something in mid-July 216 is this is when the trouble really will hit. You want to be done. You want to really be confirmed in what we're doing here by, towards the end of June, June 21st. You really want to. You don't want to wait till July. And lo and behold, we have this United Nations high-level summit meeting where they're going to now introduce the idea of that we are now monitoring every country, and every country is supposed to be monitoring every region in their country, and every region is supposed to be monitoring every person. Ultimately, it goes all the way down to every person. This is their goal now. This is the United Nations goal, is to monitor everyone in the world, actually. It's right there in the Sustainable Development Goals, goal 2030. How do we get to 2030? They said, this is how we're going to get there. We're going to have this we're going to create this data collecting agency, and they're going to put on every country in the world, and they're going to collect all this data. Well, this is the road that the future is going down very fast. Is so October, what, then November, and then we have the climate, Paris climate talks, which is, you know, people are saying this is the most important meeting in history. Okay, this is what we're going through right now. Once the if they're able to decide on a particular goal and make it legally binding, then they can start introducing the carbon tax credits, the whole thing about, you know, it'll be something legally that the countries will put upon their citizens and start rolling it out. And I'm sure they're working on all how to do all of that. They've been working on it for quite some time. So we, of course, they want to have, you know, perfect citizens behaving perfectly. But you never hear great spiritual teachers really talking that way at all. They say practice and practice more and practice more. It's not that we have to break all our bad habits necessarily, but what we need to do is we need to begin to develop really good habits of practice. And as we do that, naturally we start saying, hey, you know, this is interfering. Let me push that to a side, because this is important. This is really how you have to go about it. You can't just say, well, you're a bad person, you got to stop being a bad person. It doesn't work that way. Wherever you are, you say, okay, fine, however you are, don't worry about it, just start practicing. And then the more you practice, the more you whatever's interfering with your practice, you say, hey, I don't want to, you know, I don't want that anymore. This is how you really go about it. And they always say, do spiritual practice, don't worry, don't try to train yourself to be a good person. All right, and it's an art. It's not so. This is the right path for us, actually. And the United Nations is going down a very, very, very dark path, actually. And a lot of people, we don't want to go down that path. And if we do, we're going to lose our game, just like I lost my game today. Now, you know, I can get it back. This was an experience for me. But I'll tell you, you know, it was pretty humiliating. Good thing the guys were, you know, I mean, they couldn't talk either. They were messing up so bad. And I said, hey, it's contagious, you know. Come on, look at me. Now you got me doing this, which was true. I said, what in the world's going on? So we don't want to go down that path. That's very simple, very simple. So still, you know, what I've been saying all along is there's got to be a way to sidestep this. There has to be a way. And is that just abidance in your own our own consciousness? Or is there something more to it? We have to find that out. And so far, we don't know. But I would suspect we don't want to really hang around. There has to be some sort of retreat where you don't really hang around these folks, because they're going to be very contagious. Their attitude is going to be very, very contagious. You know, they're going to say, hey, I'm becoming a perfect citizen, and you need to also become a perfect citizen. And the world is going to become obsessed by this, actually. I mean, it's very contagious, and you get enough, you know, big mother syndrome going and telling all the children, hey, children, this is what you have to do. This is coming from on high, you know, coming down, filtering down through us, because we know how to train you. Don't worry, we'll train you properly. And, you know, get into this technology. You need to be in this. I've already experienced that. People trying to dictate to me what my life is supposed to be like vis-a-vis technology. Well, you're supposed to have this. You're supposed to do this. You're supposed to do email. You're supposed to have a smartphone. You're supposed to do this. You're supposed to do this. What's the matter with you? I've told you to do it. You're not doing it. You know, dictating. You know, trying to dictate like a mother to a child. It's like, wow. And they don't understand why you're not doing what they're telling you to, because from their mind, you are a child. You need to be taught. You need to be taught. But I would say I'm already being taught by the Holy Spirit and some great teachers, and they're not telling me to do this stuff. So you're going to run in but you can't fight City Hall. And you cannot fight Big Mother in this world, actually. Not successfully. I would not suggest anybody, just from a practical standpoint, don't mix it up with Big Mother. Okay, you're gonna lose. You're gonna lose. You know, the mother knows best. The mother syndrome is such that, you know, it's they know how to make the children behave, or else, you know, they've got all sorts of tricks, and it's just we're easily entrained that way. Culture is easily entrained that way. So it remains to be seen how to retreat. Now, I do have some a spiritual corollary I can use. That my belief is that great spiritual teachers come in the world when there's a massacre happening. And this term massacre doesn't only mean physical massacre. It could mean ideological massacres. It could mean psychological massacres. It could be a massacre of spiritual practice. In other words, a massive collapsing is like a massacre. Horrible situation you don't want to happen. And what they do is they come in to protect spiritual momentum. It's very, very important. They protect us from that. They say, we're not going to let we're not going to let you lapse. You know, we're not going to let you lapse. You work too hard. You see, it's very important to them that we succeed. I cannot imagine, you know, someone who succeeded spiritually in setting down pretense and this scam and realizing who they truly are and realizing who we all truly are. I cannot imagine them just sitting back and say, oh, well, you know, just let them lapse and lose all their momentum and finesse and doesn't matter, you know. It's just what I can't imagine that, you know they, you know they would be looking at the world and saying we want to make sure that those who have really worked diligently at this do not lapse, okay, and do not lose their momentum. And what else they got to do? I mean, you know. Really, if they're helping us out, that's how you help us out. You don't let us lose our momentum. That's extremely difficult to get. So, I would think that the great teachers come to the world when there's a massacre about to happen, and they protect those who they realize, you know, these are valuable assets. Absolutely valuable assets, because we're going to be helping them down the road. Absolutely, greatly helping them, and they would. This is what they want. So, example, very interesting example, in Dhaka, which was then East Bengal. Anandamayi Ma was living in the city of Dhaka, Shahbagh Gardens, and her husband was the supervisor of the gardening staff there. And there was this ancient Kali temple to the Indian spiritual form goddess they called Kali. It's been there for a long, long time. And then the devotees of Anandamayi Ma at that time, the early ones, built this little temple right beside the Kali temple. This was a place where many people came, Hindus of that area came to. That's a very famous Kali temple, been there a long time. So many devotees who took care of the Kali temple and took her little temple there, and it became a very big meeting place, and a lot of people came there. Now at some point she left Dhaka and went into India, and pretty much for good, did not really come back much. Occasionally she came back much. But she actually started relocating families out of Dhaka, out of East Bengal, to India. Said, come here and visit. Why don't you come live here with me? Or, you know, she kept finding ways to do this. And so a lot of people left. And then actually when the partitioning of India took place, what was that, 49 or something like that. A lot of people had left, but there were still some that said, "No, we're going to stay." So they stayed, and took care of the Kali temple, took care of her ashram there, her temple, and they said, "We're devoted to this area and to doing this." And so apparently she warned them that you know that they were risking danger, and I believe. She did her best to convince them, but they didn't want to leave. Well, Operation Searchlight, what happened was when the East Pakistan, which was what used to be East Bengal, now East Pakistan, now called Bangladesh, when they revolted against the West Pakistanis, because they were imposing their language, their culture upon East Pakistan, the Bengalis didn't want that. There was a revolution, and Western Pakistan came in with their generals and their military and everything, and they were very heavy-handed. And what happened was they carried out something called Operation Searchlight. I think that was like, was it 1970, something like that? I could be off on that date. But what they did was they went after the symbols of resistance in Bangladesh, East Pakistan at that time. They went after the university professors, University of Dhaka, there, right there in Ramna Park and Shahbag Garden area, center of Dhaka. And they rounded up the professors, the intellectuals, and the religious people. They went to the Kali Temple. They went to Anandamayi's ashram. They rounded up everybody, the women, the children, the families, everybody. They brought them outside and they massacred all of them right there, right in front of the temples, massacred them all. So, you know, Anandamayi, when people ask, why should I practice? He says, well, you know, do you ask when there's a massacre happening? Why should you flee the massacre? You know, I mean, come on. So they were warned and they did not leave. They did not leave. Massacre happened. Terrible massacre. To this day, you know, this is still a very big deal. What happened there, that situation, Operation Searchlight, and so, you know, just, you know, not everybody heeds the warnings, but certainly the teacher understood that the massacre was going to happen and tried to get everybody, you know, to safety. But some said, no, we're going to stay here. This is just sort of a real, you know, strong example. Now, during the 20th century, there were, you know, more war than any century in history, right? It was like a century of massacre is what it was throughout the planet. And if you go over all the different wars that occurred, which I've done in a video, in the 20th century, you would be absolutely astonished. We'd all would just say, I can't believe this. I cannot believe this. It's astonishing. The amount of warfare that happened. It is a century of massacre. And you have these great teachers like Ramana Maharshi and Anandamayi Ma and others at that time. Krishnamurti, you might say. He might not be on the same level as those others, but you know, this is for his name. And they may have helped us get through this century, you know, spiritually get us through, because it was a horrific century, 20th century. I mean, just you name the wars, you can, there's so many. We just think, well, it's World War I, World War II, Korean War, Vietnam. No, that's just the beginning. It goes on and on and on. Worst massacre century of massacre in history. So they came then. You see, there were great teachers in the world. Now, it's been a while since there's been those sighted teachers in the world, actually. But maybe we're reaching a time now, I believe, with this artificial intelligence and United Nations. This is a massacre. This is an ideological massacre that is underway. And I would certainly believe that some great teachers would come and help us with this. I mean, they do not want us to be sucked into this and lose our momentum. No way. You know, it's responsibility. It's just, you know, it's everything to them. They're compassionate, you know, and they don't want to see us lose our way. So I would expect they would do something. So far, they have not. Maybe they've prepped us for it. I don't know. So I hope they will do something. I don't know what it would be, but they must have a way. They must have a way. Just like Anandamayi Ma moved so many of her devotees out of East Bengal, East Pakistan, and Bangladesh, and moved them out of there, relocated them. She relocated them. So many. Oh, very quietly, without, just say, look, I think it'd be better for you if you come practice here. We have a nice place here for you to practice. Come here, and I'm here now. Could you come visit me? And then they'd come visit, and she said, why don't you stay here and do some more practice? And here, you can stay with this family or whatever. Kind of that, she had her ways of doing it. They relocated them. So we've got a massacre coming up in this world. This is how I see it. It's a good term to use, a massacre. And the world's going to be massacred by this agenda that's coming up. Agenda 21, is if you want to call it that. It's bigger than that, but that's, that's certainly a, central part of it. And we're going to, the world's going to be told that, hey, we have this legally binding agreement now that the world's doomed. You have all these, it's funny that conspiracy people are called, they're doomsdayers, and yet the UN, and all these people who are screaming about climate change, I mean, they're the doomsdayers. I mean, there's so many of them say, this planet is going to die in a couple years. It's going to be, the whole planet's going to be dead. They're screaming doomsday to everybody. They say, hey, if we don't all, get straitjacketed real soon, fitted for straitjackets, the whole world's going to die. So, when enough people catch this doomsday attitude, then you will seem to be an eco-terrorist if you don't go along. And keep in mind that I believe the term terrorism will be extended to eco-terrorism, okay? I really believe that. And of course, there's a global police force that the President of the United States is in charge of right now. The UN put him in charge to structure a global police force designed to counter terrorism, to avoid any movement of money or persons or ideology or teachings or anything about terrorism anywhere on the planet. He's in charge of this. Well, when they extend terrorism to eco-terrorism, you're not going along with, saving the planet from death. What are you going to do? What are you going to do then? You see? That's not a good situation. All this stuff is brewing. There's a big, big storm brewing, to say the very least. And it's not enough just to go along. You're going to have to be an activist. People are going to be judged on, their level of activism. Well, I'm saying, hey, I need to, spiritual practice is my activism. All right, this is my activism. This is true activism. And they'll say, no, that has nothing to do with it. You got to stop that. You can't give that time. You got to pursue our goals, what, our goals are. So this is a great collapsing. Everyone lapsed. To lapse means to fall backward, right? I lapsed. I'm no longer as good as I used to be. I'm no longer as advanced. I fell backwards. I fell down, so to speak. And co means together, lapsing together. This is what I saw in the dream, a great collapse, the world's worst collapse in history. It was just astonishing how bad it was. This is what I see coming. So it is a massacre. It's a massacre. Now, I'm getting indications that Ananda My Ma is in the picture somehow. All right? She's a very, very, how would you say it? Skillful, resourceful, very resourceful teacher, and skillful in this kind of avoiding massacre situation. Very adept and resourceful and skillful at it. And also, the biggest champion of spiritual practice, and I think the world's ever seen, actually. Is to call her the Tiger of Bengal, because she was ferocious about insisting that we practice, 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 relentless, relentless. The Tiger of Bengal. So she's a ferocious protector of practicing spiritual practice and spiritual culture. So I wouldn't be, slightest bit surprised if somehow she so shows up on the scene to help us, escape, avoid this massacre, this collapsing that is going to take place very soon. Very soon. It's already happening. There's all sorts of bad situations happening around me already. people are taking hardline activist attitudes now. The call has already gone forth to be activists now, and to put down somebody else is not, you know, activist, and view them as undesirables, you know, enemies. It's already happened. It's already happening now. So the collapsing is, you know, it is, it's coming. It's coming, it's coming, it's coming. The first part of the rain, the storm, you can see that the rain is starting to come down, the wind. I mean, it's starting to storm, it's starting to get stormy. This is just the beginning of the storm. It's terrible. I have had indications that the tiger of Bengal is somehow prowling around somewhere. I don't know exactly, you know. How can you know when a tiger is prowling? You never see them. They're so good at camouflage until they pounce, you know. Only this tiger is a good tiger, you know. It's not going to devour us. Well, it might spiritually devour us, you know, in terms of practice. Come on. We can do it. You can do it. And Jesus is back. I don't know, you know, where, what he's doing exactly. So there are teachers back. And Longchenpa advised me that he is back somehow. I don't know how. You know, they know their business, and how they know how to carry out their business. And so we may not be privy to, you know, how they do what they do, but they're doing it. So there is this collapsing coming, a great collapsing it back into materiality, back into personality, personness. And I was stuck in a situation where I had to watch the TV. Where was it? I was somewhere. Oh, okay. Yeah, today. And I was waiting for something in the office, and the television was on. So I said, oh, nothing to do. Let me see what television is like now, because I don't watch it. I've stopped watching it altogether now. Not even baseball. And, oh, my gosh. I mean, it's just like, whoa. And I was watching the Mad Hatter's Tea Party. It's just, everybody is just into the personality. It's a cult of personality we have in the world right now. And of course, we want well-behaved personalities. You know, and everybody's thinking, well, I'm a well-behaved personality. I'm fine. Are you well-behaved? I'm a well-behaved personality. Very activist about it. It's just, I could hardly believe what I was seeing. I just said, uh-oh. This is horrible, absolutely horrible. This is the world. This is what's going on. So, you know, when's the tiger of Bengal going to pounce and help us out? When's Jesus going to say, hey, friend, you know, let's go talk over here? And, you know, something. We got to get some separation here between the personality cult of the world and our own focus. You know, you cannot hang out with the people who are into a personality cult. You're gonna be severely affected. Absolutely. Only the great teachers are not affected by that. The rest of us, we absolutely will end up acting that way, you know. Just like I ended up playing bad golf. If you're around people who are into personality cult, you're gonna start just, you know, because you want to be accommodating and nice and good, and you don't want to stand out and seem too different or anything. So you end up, you know, when in Rome, do as Romans do. All but a few are like this. And so a great collapsing is coming. A great collapsing is coming. No question about it. Now, the great teachers, you know, how are they going to do what they do? I don't know. I just feel that they will. I don't really know how they manage. They're so resourceful. We just don't understand what they can do. But I hold out prayers and affirmations and preparation that in some way they're going to help us out. I can't imagine that they would not. And interesting, I couldn't drive the ball after getting with these guys. I could not drive the ball. I absolutely could not. I could not drive the golf ball. I said, what in the world is going on here? It's crazy. So I lost my drive. This is also symbolic. If you hang around people with a personality cult, they're not practicing at all. You lose your drive to practice. You lose it. I lost it. I said, this is crazy. I went home and swung the club a few times and I got it back. I said, oh boy, where was that on the golf course? It's completely gone. Same thing with the personality cult of the world. You hang around the personality cult of the world, you lose your drive to really, really practice effectively. For example, Nanda Maima put a premium on hanging around spiritual people who are practicing. Put a premium on this. This is extremely important. So if you hang around with the people who are not wrong people, you're going to become like them and you're going to lapse. It's true. It's true. I lapsed today in the golf. they must have thought I was just, I don't know, some sort of idiot out there. But occasionally I'd get it back and hit some great shot. And they'd kind of say, what? What was that? You know? I said, well, you know, that's how I should be hitting it. But I'm completely out of sorts. I even hit out of turn. You know, I said, what am I doing? I was so discombobulated. I forgot to wait my turn instead of, wow. And they said, ah, it's okay, don't worry about that. So, you end up losing your finesse, your etiquette, everything elapses. And of course, the personality cult said, oh, it's okay. You know, as long as you're a nice personality cult person, it's all okay. This is the danger of this world, is that the personality believes, the belief is that, well, all these bad habits, you know, the person, I got all these bad habits. So the person, I said, you know what? If we all just agree that we all have these bad habits, excuse me. My breathing is being affected. Wow. Maybe I'm saying too much here. Suddenly my breathing became affected. See, the intensity is too strong. Wow. Now, it's possible, in order to prepare for some sort of sidestepping, is that we need to be given permission to not say anything. Whereas we're taught to be in this behavioralistic, materialistic society, we're supposed to be responding, giving feedback. But really, one of the best practices is to be silent. You have the right to say nothing in a social setting. Don't say anything. Don't have to give your opinion or do anything. You don't have to do anything. Don't have to say anything. This might be very helpful. I've often thought about this as you know, this might be the most helpful. It's just let people come and say, we're just going to not do anything and we're not going to say anything. And we're just going to practice not saying or doing anything. And this will give you some sort of leverage over the world. The direction the world's going, you begin to have leverage over, and you say, "Well, I don't have to go along in that direction." So, this might be something that comes about. I think that most people are not ready for advanced teachings right now, practices, but the silent, I'm not going to do anything or say anything, full stop on the wow, just be quiet. They might be able to do that. They might be able to do that. So I hope something like this can happen. Because again, the world is headed towards a situation where everybody thinks that having bad habits is okay, and say we all have the habits, so they can't be bad. And they're going to celebrate their bad habits and empower them and say, "This is great. Having bad habits is a good thing." But then they say, "Well, I don't have a problem. As long as I see bad habits as being good, I don't have a problem." This is the ideology the world's going toward. I saw a guy yesterday walking down the street. Man, I'm telling you, he stood out. He really stood out. And I said, "Uh-oh, this is bad." He was one of those figures that you see now in the world. You know, completely shaven head, you know, utterly shaven head and countenance. And he's wearing just these low slung swimming trunks, almost, you know, kind of gangster swimming trunks, real low, and flip-flops. That's all he was wearing. And his whole body was like tattooed with all these, you know, just bizarre tattoos. And the way that he walked, you know, it was like a, I said, "Holy cow, this is just a weird, this is very, it is like a gangster, sort of some sort of frightening person." And it just, the way he walks, there's like this an odd walk, you know, and you could just tell his consciousness was very in a very odd place, to say the least. And he's looking at his smartphone, you know, he just walks in. I said, "What's he doing? I mean, walking out in public like this, just and he's just, you know, showing this is who I am, the tattoos and the way I look and everything is just wow." He stood out just glaringly, you know, glaringly in a negative way. And yet, you know, this will be seen as, "Oh, this is great. Everybody should have, you know, demonic tattoos. Everybody should look this way. Everybody should, these aren't bad habits. These are good habits. This is a good human being. This is good. Bad habits are good. You know, we don't want to say we have bad habits." And the whole planet is going this way. Collapsing, lapsing together. This is the kind of guy, if you're a policeman, you would like slow your car down and just say, "Hey, who are you? We want to watch you." You know, you know, it's just like a criminal mentality or something. It's like you just feel it. Wow. And yet the world is full of these types of people that everybody says, "Oh, wonderful people. We welcome them. We welcome diversity. As long as everybody has bad habits, we have a diversity of bad habits, and then we'll all be righteous, self-righteous. Look how wonderful you are. We allow this vast potpourri of bad habits. We encourage it." People now don't even realize they have such bad habits, and they need to start building in good habits to their lives of spiritual practice. Otherwise, they're going to be in they're going to lapse really badly, and be like lost sheep. So, you know, the good shepherd looks after the flock. I mean, this is the whole point of Christianity, is the good shepherd. And Jesus is called the good shepherd. He looks out after the flock, meaning those who are, you know, following him, practicing. Doing right spiritual discipline, right spiritual practice. These are his sheep. Okay, and he says the sheep know my voice, you know, and I know theirs. So the whole idea of the good shepherd is you do shepherd those on the spiritual path and look out after them. This is why I've been so activist about denouncing the Pope Francis. You know, I don't believe he's doing a good job shepherding. He's leading the flock right into the den of wolves. But you know, Jesus is what we say the good shepherd. So we are waiting to see what he does. We have to be shepherd, you know, better. We need to be protected. The shepherd has the back of the sheep. I mean, the idea of the shepherd has got the staff. And if any of the wild animals come lurking, the shepherd, you know, will go after him and say, hey, stay away from my sheep. Stay away from my sheep. Keeps robbers away, you know, everything that would harm, anything that would harm the sheep, the good shepherd looks after the sheep and keeps the harm away from them. Well, this is a fundamental principle of Christianity, actually. So right now, Christians are just getting massacred in the world, ideologically. So, you know, where's the good shepherd? Where's the shepherding? We need it. We need it. It may be different than, it may come, I don't know what Jesus is going to do. But I'll tell you, we need that shepherding, no question about it. I invited all the teachers who have ever been and are right now. I invited them here to help us out. I said, you know, whoever can help have our backs and help protect us, you know, you're welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. But we need it now. We need it right now. Things are already collapsing. Already collapsing. The momentum is a steamroller. It happened in September. I said September is the most pivotal month in world history, and it is true. And the momentum from that now is steamrolling into the climate pre-climate talks in Bonn, Germany, and I believe they started either now or in a few days, and then to Paris, just a commune north of Paris, where this is the big powwow. You know, of course, France being the feeling that they are the, you know, the heart of humanism in the world, secular humanistic republic. So it's apropos that they would hold this, you know, super important humanistic meeting there to start, you know, to launch, you know, the campaign towards everyone being perfect humans. So it's a massacre. So we'll see how the shepherds show up. Who are the shepherds that show up? You know, by their fruits ye shall know them. By their fruits. And so there's a time for us to evaluate, you know, who's got our back? Who has our back? Who are the good shepherds right now? This is what we need to find out and experience for ourselves. Now I recalled, you know, how to drive the golf ball properly. I forgot for a whole course. I couldn't do it. Well, who wants to go through this tribulation time where we just lapse and go through this horrible suffering and misery? Why? How did I forget that? You know, how did I possibly forget it? But I did. That's the crazy thing. Under the pressure of the personality cult, we forget our spiritual truths. We forget them. We lapse. There's no question about it. I'm not immune from lapsing. Absolutely not. I dare say there's very few in this world who are immune to it. I mean, exceedingly few. Under the pressures that are going to come. And again, don't think that the troubles won't come to, if you're spiritual, just like those Kali devotees and And Doc Ock, you know, didn't save him. Didn't save him. He got massacred. So, you know, be humble enough to say, hey, I'm not yet, you know, perfectly liberated from self-delusion here. So this makes us very vulnerable to massive global pressure. And if somebody is immune, good for them. That's great. That doesn't mean that it doesn't affect my decision. I'm not competing with anyone anywhere. Not competing with anyone. So it's just like in golf. You're only competing with yourself, really. You got to play your game and not worry about how others are playing. And then let the chips fall where they may. So. If you feel that you're immune to it all, if somebody feels they're immune to it all, well then great, let them do what they want to do. But it doesn't affect my evaluation at all. My evaluation at this point is I'm not immune to it. I'm not immune to total global pressure that's to come. Absolutely not. Maybe driven to distraction by it. So I'm certainly looking for some help. I think it's a perfect setup here is that someone who has momentum, is very good at practicing, very much pursued a culture of practicing their whole life, and saying, hey, I need some help. I don't think I can withstand the pressure. Well, this is a perfect emergency, for some teachers to help out now. In fact, Ananda Maimon did say, people asked her, why aren't you helping everybody out? And she says, well, look, a mother knows when their child is just crying out of frustration or some scratch or some little, it's not that important. But she can differentiate between that cry and the cry if their child is in serious danger, from a snake, a tiger, or, some terrible situation. The mother knows the difference, right? From the cries of the child. So she said, if you're really in trouble, it's a real emergency, it's a real trouble, she said, I guarantee, that I'll help you out, guarantee it. But I don't always respond to those who feel they're in trouble, because they may just, they're not in such severe trouble as they think. So I would say right now we're in severe trouble. Okay, really severe trouble. And this is how I see it. And I put out the cry today, plea, hey, well, this is an emergency right now. We are in an incredible emergency situation. This agenda is going to be shoved down everybody's throats very, very soon. I mean, in Paris, it's going to happen, right? And they're determined this time to push it through. It's more than the Kyoto Protocol. I mean, this is a legally binding, the difference is they're going to actually set a mark, whether it's two degrees Celsius or what is it, centigrade, or I don't know, or 1.5, whatever reductions they want. They want to agree. They want everyone to agree and legally binding. And so you have this global now. You have this mark. Maybe it's the mark of the beast. Who knows? This commune is like 6.6 miles from Paris. Pretty interesting. So the mark, agreed upon mark, global, this changes everything. Because then you can start assessing progress towards this. And everyone says, okay, now we know what we have to get to. Therefore, now we can pass all these laws, and this is how we're going to get in. The roadmap very rapidly takes shape. But if there's all these global disagreements and no one's yet agreed legally what the mark is, then how do you do that? So their goal in Paris climate change talks is to agree upon a mark. Interesting. Maybe the beast is all the heads of all the nations of the world. The mark of the beast. The mark that the beast sets. The beast sets this mark for the world. Pretty interesting, isn't it? I noticed a lot of stuff. A symbology about this conference is, wow. This is pretty, a little bit alarming. So it changes everything. And again, today's the 14th. So we have, what, 17 more days in October. And then November 30, so that's 47 days. And then another, what, 47, another 15, 47, 57, 63, maybe 66 days or something till the from right now till the conference in Paris. It might even be 66 days from now. And that's it. And then this so it's going to happen. You know, it's likely to happen. This is a big, 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 big historic situation. It doesn't get any bigger than this, historic-wise, okay? This is a completely important historical moment coming up. When it's a shift in the ideology of the world to globalism, right? Absolutely it is. It is coming up in about 66 days. From today, you know, around there, thereabouts. I can't remember what date actually starts, but you know, we're in the 60s, I would think, you know. And that's it. So we had better get help now. We had better get help now. We don't want to be caught unawares by this, you know. After the fact, like, oh, really, something happened? You know, I don't really, you know, but we're dazed and confused by it. There's going to be this rush of globalism. I feel that the young people especially are going to, it's going to activate them. They've been waiting for this moment. This is what I believe. Especially the people under 30 have been waiting for this moment. And when it happens, you know, it's going to transform their personalities, actually. It's going to, activism is suddenly going to arise. You know, for me, I see these young people have this latent activism. They're very wannabe activists, but they don't quite yet have the leverage to justify it, you know. They're not able to justify it properly yet. Once they get this global mark in Paris, then they'll say, we got the leverage now. And the activism is going to suddenly, you know, emerge and boil, start boiling over. I say, hey, it's time to take action now. And we have an agreement. And again, the Pope, President, they said, well, we won't get in the way of this. They've already signed on to it and said, we won't get in the way. Don't worry. Just go for it. So, we don't want to wait for Operation Searchlight to happen. We want to flee the area before. I mean, we want to get out of Dodge before the gunfight happens, not after. So we want something before this Paris climate talks happen. All right, we want something solid. I mean, something substantial before this happens. This is what I'm very, very adamant about. And we don't have to know how everything plays out. We just want to feel, hey, we've got something substantial. That's enough, just to feel that way. We don't have to know how all the future is going to play out and all the details and everything. But just to say, hey, you know what? We have a good shepherd. We have some good shepherding looking out after us. We know that we're being looked out after. This is really important. Otherwise, these activists are going to, you know, the bullying is going to be off the charts. It already is. Get sucked into the cult of personality, and you know, it's like, you know, the message is given out to the army ants, and they all start marching. Somehow chemically, they'd say it's time to march, soldier ants. You know, that in Africa they just go through and just devour everything in their path. You get out of their path. Nothing is left. And yet, most of the time, they don't do that. It's like the locust swarm. Same thing. You got to realize, in nature, there are these swarms, these plagues that take place. what was the Colorado locust? I mean, the Rocky Mountain locust. I mean, back what 150 years ago or something, there was a swarm of locusts that covered pretty much most of the Western United States. I mean, it was so huge. It was the biggest swarm in history. Trillions and trillions of these, some kind of, you know, locust-like creature. You know, it's unbelievable. And they were swarming, and now they're pretty much gone and almost extinct. Maybe they are extinct. Pretty extraordinary. But you know, why do the locusts swarm? Why do insects? Why do birds? Why are these? Why does this happen? You know, if we're not sure. You know, there's triggers. There are triggers in nature for massive swarming, and you might call it insect and animal activism. Okay. It, before that, you don't even notice it. I mean, they didn't. There weren't all these locust people weren't noticing them. Then suddenly, they just came out of the ground by the trillions. It was a famous locust swarm, Rocky Mountain locust. You can Google it. It's not a swarm. So, human, what we call quote unquote human, this dance of imagination we call humans. Who's to say that humans don't have the same sort of trigger mechanism to swarm, to become activist? Everything seems calm, you know, calm enough, and suddenly everyone seems to wake up, seems to get activist all at once and saying, you know, time to go, we got to do this, time to march. And they, just like that, I mean, we can't overlook this possibility. Cannot overlook this possibility. Just like the United States, World War II, you know, we're going along, and you know, everything's fine. We love it. This is a nice time. And then Pearl Harbor happened. You know, overnight, the whole country suddenly became activist. Just like that. You know, it was an event which, you know, triggered it, that thing. And, you know, my parents' generation, they were going to college then, and everything was just beautiful and idyllic. And where, if you're in Southern California, you know, going to college, and great life. And then Pearl Harbor happened the next day, that the induction center, and then a few days later they're on a train to basic training. After several months of brutal basic training, you know, they're shipped out to the war, and that's it. So in a time of maybe 3 months' time or less, they're on the battlefield somewhere, World War II. Iwo Jima, Guadalcanal, or one of the islands for, you know, the Americans are fighting in the Eastern War. Just super fast. The whole country just galvanized like that. So there, we have many examples in history of humanity suddenly becoming very activist in a certain direction. And so we have to believe that trying to get my back, it's hurting from the golf, I can't get this level, that this climate talk situation is potentially could trigger activism throughout the world. It really could trigger it. You get all these heads of state giving speeches all over the world simultaneously and saying, we've now decided and we've now agreed and now it's time to get after this in the most intense way possible. It's go time. It's going to happen, isn't it? This is not just an activism like the United States getting World War II. This is a global activism of 193 countries, every country in the world except North Korea and the Vatican, I guess, are signatories to United Nations. It might be one other, but who's not? This is globalism. This is a global activism. This is very different. We've never had this before. Or the whole, you know, United States had, you know, civil rights movement, and there's been various things. The closest we had maybe is, well, feminism might be a global thing, and then gay rights would be another global thing that's somewhat, you know, the global activism around the world. But this thing is, could be 190th, every country in the world could suddenly at the same time say, it's go time, Every leader of the country has signed on already to the Sustainable Development Goals in September. That may be that they all sign on to this climate accord. At that point, they will all start saying, you know, children, comrades, whatever, citizens, we have a goal, and now it's time to reach that goal. Go. You know, that's it. Go. You got to go for it right now. And this could transform the entire globe right now in terms of its ideology, and could sweep us away from our focus on spiritual awakening from this incredibly detailed scam that we're running of existence. It's very difficult to see through this, but it takes a lot of focus, a lot of work. It has to be your central focus of your life. You cannot make working on climate change the central goal of your life and still awaken, you know. It doesn't work that way. You can live a low, you know, low carbon life. You can do things, sure. Like in the drought, we're doing a lot of things. But you still have to do spiritual practice. That has to be the most important. You have to realize this is what's really important. But this could flip-flop very soon into saying, no, nothing else is important. This is all important. And then you get pulled into the carbon tax credit thing and, you know, all sorts of monitoring and pressures, and you know, it just builds, it goes on and on and on and on and on, and we realize we're in over our heads here. Buyer's regret. So this is coming very soon. We need something concrete, substantial, absolutely substantial at this point. Now, a very weird thing happened today at golf. I couldn't, my driver, the ball wasn't going very far. And it's like, wow. And yet, this is bizarre. The four hybrid, I hit a four hybrid when the ball's in the rough and I need to advance it really, you know, pretty far. And well, I hit it and I said, well, I hit that okay. And then I go look for it. I say, I can't find it. Where is it? I keep looking. And then I look up ahead, way far down the fairway. There's my ball. I say, that's not possible. I couldn't hit it that far. What? It happened again and again and again. It's like hitting a four hybrid with the new golf balls I've got. It just goes a mile. I don't know how to explain it. Very, very odd. With that one club, it just seems to just, wow. Does it go? Amazing distance. If I can just get it to go that way from that driver, everything's like, wow, everything's fine. We'll see. And so maybe there's a way, you know, that we can practice or something, that a groove we can get into that will really, really advance us, you know, tremendously past the trouble, past these troubles. There probably is. There probably is a focus that we could get into. That we say, wow, this really works for us. And the other stuff may not be work so well, but something that just really, you know, just seems just right, really works. So I'll keep working. We all will keep working here, but fast, and it has to happen real soon. We need something substantial. And we understand why now, right? We understand why this global activism could be triggered overnight in December. I've said, and not just me, but others too, that by Christmas of this year, you know, the world's going to be fundamentally different place. The end of this year is really going to catapult the situation going into next year in a very severe way. And now we know that these climate talks, you know, are likely to be the cause. We'll see what false flags are brought up, etc. But this is likely to be the cause of a fundamental shift, ideological shift in the world. And then given impetus in July, full impetus in July of this year, I say, okay, we are now watching you. We are now evaluating you. We are now collecting data on you. We are now monitoring your progress on a global basis because we have the legal authority to do so. To make this this climate change, to give legal authority, binding legal authority, will also, they'll take that as legal authority to assess our progress on it, you see. And this is all inclusive, isn't it, to your life. And they'll grandfather in the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which was agreed upon already in September, and it'll all be one lump of coal where, you know, your progress, legally the government will feel they have a right to monitor your progress, everybody's progress on this. And they're in over their heads, you know. They just want to make a perfect little utopia, human being utopia here. That's not where it's at. None of the great teachers advise they're supposed to make a human utopia here. They said you're supposed to wake up and realize everything is already perfect. Nothing you need to do to make it perfect. It's already perfect. Everyone has perfect standing already. There's nothing we need to do to make it so. So if we can get in the groove of substantiality here. The UN has something substantial, the humanists have something substantial, they got this Paris meeting, this is very substantial. We need something substantial, a good shepherd. We need good, substantial good shepherding right now. Not just vague this, vague that. That's I don't think that's going to cut it anymore. So, you know, hopefully we've done the right amount of preparation and practice and full stop on the wow. We were able to go into the wow, full stop on the wow mode when we're shocked and stunned and let that continuity fear evaporate, and we have the techniques that work. So we can handle something substantial more than we're used to. I mean, this is the pivotal moment in history, actually. The September was in effect, that was the beginning of the pivot and the Sustainable Development Goals Summit and the Pope coming to the United States. And then in the climate change talks in Paris, this, you know, cements the situation. It really puts a capstone on it. Well, the ultimate capstone is in July of 2016. But this, you know, gives the go signal. Okay, everybody go for it now. This is it. This is the globalization is now here. So, you know, these are deadlines. These are hard deadlines we're looking at. And so we've got every right. Everyone has every right to say, hey, this is an emergency right now. If you want an emergency, teachers, well, we got one right now. We have one right now. A severe emergency. Such a severe emergency, it should be enough to pull you out of, you know, wherever you are, at least make some sort of showing here. Is that severe? You know, if you can bilocate while you're here, you probably can bilocate from whatever, you know, completely abstract state you are in, and I'll bilocate here also some way. I don't see why not. But good shepherding right now is what we need. Now, yeah, everybody's got a different opinion on this, and we're giving ours here, so. we want not just a good shepherd, but good shepherding, truly effective shepherding right now, given the circumstances that are coming. It's got to be pragmatic. It has to be pragmatic. Given what we know is likely to occur, we need that, the shepherding that effectively deals with this and has our backs and protects us, finds a way to protect us from the pressures that will come. Very simple. Well, we will see how it turns out here. We've had the books, we've had our practicing, we've done all this stuff. Now, you know, we need something more substantial that we can rely upon and say, hey, you know, so-and-so says this, and so-and-so advises this, and this is the option that we're doing, and this is why we're doing it. We're out of an abundance of caution, you know, we're making sure that we're insulated in case this wave of activism hits and pulls us, you know, into a personality focus. It could get out of control, and we don't want to. So it would be very helpful to have that sort of thing in place before the troubles, you know, strike the world. And there is a, you know, there is the capability easily now for a global database, easily. And they definitely intend to have a global database on every citizen in the world. This is ultimately their goal. And they can do it easily now. They even say they got to make specific great efforts to set up these data centers in undeveloped countries. They say there's some countries in the world who don't have the data collection ability right now, so we got to make sure that they have that as soon as possible. Again, nobody left behind, every single citizen. This is their mantra. Nobody left behind, every single citizen on this planet. Of course, there's the goal of the technology companies like Google, for instance, and companies that are photographing every place in the world, trying to, you know, collect data on as many people as possible. I mean, their goal is globalism. Every single person in this world, they want to know who you are and where you are, what you're doing, what you're thinking, what your expectations are, your habits, your lifestyle, you know, everything about you. They want to have it in a global database. Every website you go to, every video you watch, everything. And then they'll calculate, you know, some eco score of how you're doing. Oh, you're spending time watching, 2.5 hours watching this. Well, that's 2.5 hours wasted, they will say. You know, this doesn't have anything to do. You need to spend your 2.5 hours watching some other TV program designed to inform you about how you can be a better, more perfect citizen. See how it goes like that. The snooping ability right now in the world is astonishing. The ability to snoop on everybody is just astonishing, and all that technology is available. So, you know, again, it's here, it's not, and the wave is likely to, you know, start having troubles with it starting in December. We're already having pre-troubles with it. As like a tsunami comes in, there starts to be a storm surge. It's like, wow, what is this? And then the bigger tsunami comes in December, and then it may have reached, you know, full flooding in by July, so to speak, of 2016. So indications are something substantial is in the works. This is what I'm noticing. And it should be. It should be. The time is now for this to happen. Absolutely should be. After September, okay, where, you know, all of our countries indicated they signed on to the 17 Sustainable Goals, and they've indicated the willingness now to go to Paris and hammer out an agreement. So we're now in a time frame in October here where something substantial needs to show up. Substantial shepherding needs to show up. No question about it. And this is where my attention is getting drawn more and more. Something substantial has to show up. Substantial shepherding must show up now. Okay, this is the time frame for it to show up, in between September and December of 2015. Okay, it needs to show up. I believe it will show up. I believe that I was given indications 2015 is the year that we will get something substantial showing up here. I don't know how it will happen, actually. But I will leave that up to those whose business it is to know, you know, how to do it, whatever it is. I don't know. Just, but, you know, we can get with it. We can get with it and try to keep your good habits going, whatever your good habits are going. I'm trying to do that. Still trying to lose weight. It's been how long? 44 days or something. I've been, or more. Of dieting, and I just hit this plateau. I couldn't get any lower, so I'm trying to push it lower now. I'm, you know, drinking some fruit smoothies in the morning and fruit smoothies in the evening, and that's it. Exercising, trying to get some exercise, so I'm you know, lighter, more mobile, feeling better about myself a little bit, just superficially, but it helps a little bit. Getting a haircut, you know, just dressing neat and feeling like I'm very, you know, trying to feel functional and you know, look out after the basics in your life. You know, whatever could happen, not watching any TV, really not watching the news, looking at the internet news, not newspaper, nothing. Cut out all that, cut the radio out. All this stuff's already been, you know, pushed to the side. It's already been put on the back burner, all this stuff. So stick with those kind of good habits. Not watching the baseball player, you know, none of that stuff. So this is the sort of preparation, you know, prepping for, you know, some sort of being able to focus in on some substantial, sustainable, spiritual shepherding. So we can have that in place just in case things get a little out of control here in the world, which they could. They could. We don't want to be overwhelmed by what happens. And, of course, a lot of people want to be overwhelmed. They think that'll make them really activist. But the most important activist is a spiritual practice. So you don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater. And, you know, that's a bad thing if it happens. Like Ron Marcy said, the best thing anyone can do for the world is their own abidance in the self. He says nothing comes close. So we don't want to lose focus on that, because ultimately that's what helps everyone, including the planet, because we'll free the planet from all our projections upon it. Everything we're doing now is just a projection. You know, the collection of all projections is what we call the planet. It's all just projections, mental projections. So, you know, let us free ourselves from, you know, from all our mental projections. Ultimately, there isn't even a planet, ultimately, really, at all. Nor are there what we call human beings or anything. It's all projection. So this is what has to be realized. So you can't have the baby thrown out with the bathwater, is what we're saying here. This would be a disaster. So I certainly believe that there should be safeguards in place to make sure that those who are, you know, very, you know, those who are advanced and have been working towards this don't slip, you know, lose their footing and get pulled down with everybody else. So they maintain their focus, because this is ultimately what helps everybody. This is what actually helps everybody. You don't want to lose that high finesse, spiritual finesse that understands, because then everyone will be in a very lost situation. Lost sheep for sure. Overwhelmed by artificial intelligence. We don't want that. So maybe we just pray for, you know, firm substantiality, substantial shepherding right now. Substantial spiritual shepherding right now. We can get it. We will get it. We've already gotten it. It's here. It's absolutely here. It's here. It's here. It's here. It's here. It's here. It's here right now. And try this practice. It's here right now. The substantial spiritual shepherding is here right now. We've got it. So rehearse like that, as if it's already taken place. We've already got it. We've got it. Then you can relax. You feel, if you feel like this release, oh, relax. That means you've been practicing well, that you just, you know, oh, relief, because you're able to practice this way. So substantial spiritual shepherding is already here right now. We've got it. But don't try and imagine how we got it and what form we have it. Just in abstractly, in principle, we said, well, look, you know, we've got it, we've got it. We don't need to be fussing about anything, do we, thinking about it. We've got it. We've already got it. We've got what we need. We've already have what we need. And so we can relax the mind, release the thoughts of struggling. We can have it. We will have it. We already have it. We already have the substantial spiritual shepherding that we need. It's already in place. We have it already. Just to make sure, the baby isn't thrown out with the bathwater. The potential is there, so err on the side of caution. Let's be very cautious about this. Let's make sure that doesn't happen. Then maybe people say, well, there's only a 10% chance that may happen. Well, 10% chance is way too high. Even a 1% chance is way too high. We want a 0% chance that it'll happen. And the only way to assure that is to have a substantial spiritual shepherding that has our backs and protects us. We want it to be 0%, not 1%, 10%, whatever. Okay, 0. No possibility of it happening. None. And we want this guaranteed. We want to do as much as possible to guarantee it. As much as possible to guarantee this. And that brings in substantial spiritual shepherding, right? If we didn't do that, we'd say, well, we didn't do as much as possible, which is stupid. Because this is probably the most vulnerable time in history for something to happen to our spiritual momentum. The most vulnerable time in history. So it would be crazy not to do everything possible we could, including substantial spiritual shepherding. Absolutely nuts. Reckless. Very reckless to not do that. And something this important, recklessness is irresponsible. Very irresponsible. We don't want to be very responsible. We'd be bad citizens. We'd be being very bad citizens if we were totally responsible like this. So we want to be good citizens too. You see? I want to be a good citizen too. It's just I have a fuller definition of what a good citizen is. So nobody has a right to tell me I can't be a good citizen. I say, well, you know, wider picture, what a really great citizen. I want to be a great citizen. Protect, make sure that the high spiritual teaching of the truths, the momentum, understanding is protected and is not thrown out. Protect it. This is being a great citizen. So we respect those who want to be good citizens. We also respect those who want to be great citizens. And we don't need to be in conflict with one another here. The more great citizens, good citizens, great citizens, okay. Wonderful. Wonderful. But we don't want just great citizens and good citizens and nothing else. Just good citizens, nothing else. No. Because what about the great citizens? We don't want to forget about them. Because those are the ones that really help out. So it would be extremely irresponsible to not protect great citizenness. Okay? Very great. All right. So, we've got this. And, well, we'll see where this goes. You know, we keep moving, you know, moving the ball down the fairway. You know, it's played, what was it, 560-yard par 5 today, just about, from the backs. And I hit a 9-iron, like, you know, 10 feet from the pin. putting for just missed a birdie by, you know, tiny bit. 560 yard par five, you know, no problem. So just, you know, moving the ball down the fairway. You just hit one good shot, you hit another good shot, you hit another good shot, and, you know, there you are. There you are. So this is what we're doing. We're trying to just hit good shots, good videos, good focus, move us forward. And, you know, so before you know it, we're on the green and finished the hole, and everything went great. Easy, easy, easy. It's easy if you hit great shots, of course. Okay, very great. We'll stop this one now, and we'll see what transpires next. This is very, very compelling. That's it.